Hello and welcome to the inaugural episode. Wait, inaugural is the beginning, right? Like, that's how that works?
It's the very comeback episode.
One. The comeback. What, okay. It is. So we're coming back. I don't know. Did we really leave? We were in your hearts, right, guys? Like, if you're in someone's heart, you can never really leave. Like, I know you guys are in my hearts. But anyway, we're back here. Game Out Loud podcast, your one and only podcast for all things gaming. Episode 193, I believe, which, yeah, that's No Man's Sky territory, gentlemen. We've survived long enough to see this thing released. We'll get more on that later. But I think we're going to follow somewhat of a structure that we used to. So I think we're going to change it up a little bit because it's been a while since we've heard from everybody, especially Mr. Whack Jeffso here. Well, it's mirrored, so he's over here. Mr. Whack Jeffso, I apologize, Jack Wefso. How have you been, sir? What have you been up to?
Hey, it's good to see you guys. I can't remember the last time I was on. Not a lot. Same old, working, living, and gaming. It's nice to see you guys again.
Indeed, you as well, sir. And how about you, Mr. Peterson, looking snazzy there with that slick back hair and that manly beard?
Yeah.
A little itch there?
Yeah, a little itch.
You might want to get that finger under control. Was that a baby I heard in the background?
Oh, yes. The baby's crying.
Oh,
I gotta go.
You are a father, so we're gonna go ahead and we're gonna wait. You don't need to go. Okay, I was actually gonna cover for you there. No problem. I am here as well. Dylan, unfortunately, is not. He will be coming back, but he moved into the middle of nowhere, where apparently internet is a highly prized commodity that only one company allows you to have, and they have the worst customer service ever. So we'll get back from him later. But video games are
Comcast.
What's at hand. No, worse than Comcast, actually. At least you can get a hold of somebody at Comcast.
Okay.
Well, at least I can. I don't know.
All right.
Comcast gets a lot of flack, but I've never had a huge problem with them. But, I mean,
I wouldn't mind getting a hold of somebody at Comcast by the throat.
Yeah, oh. I suppose. Yeah, I'm with you on that.
Okay, so I'm outvoted here. 2-1, Comcast is bad. So, let's talk more about video games, because I've been playing quite a few. Rob, can you please
online, ask, using Comcast services, probably.
Indeed.
Yeah, very fast, as have I.
Yeah, very fast, reliable internet connection, at least on my end. But, Rob, could you do me a favor and ask Jack what he's been playing?
Okay. What have you been playing, Jack?
Video games.
Good.
I thought that was a setup. What have I been? I've been playing way too much No Man's Sky, and I know that's the topic for today. So I won't dive into that too much. Suffice it to say that it's been out for like 4 or 5 days, and I'm around 80 hours into it. I've really laid in some time the last few days on that one. But I'm trying to think of other
in few days. Few is usually used as a term of 3 to 5. You would have literally had to have put
that. Yeah, I did it. I did like 12-hour days. I did 2 or 3. So maybe not 80 hours. Coming up on 60, though, probably. Because I did 2 or 3 12-hour days.
That's impressive. And easy to do in that game.
Yeah, really easy to do. And I'm not working right now. I have the time. But other than that, what else have I been playing? I got the Earth Defense Force game that just came out for PC.
Okay.
Or maybe came out last year. Do you guys play Earth Defense Force at all? Anybody here in Earth Defense Force?
EDF is not my thing.
Okay.
I've heard of it.
I really like them because what I really like about them is they're split screen, every one of them. So you can just shoot at giant aliens with your friends on the couch, which is always a big sell for me. And even the PC version has split screen, which is really cool. It's one of those like destructible environments, and they give you rocket launchers and ask you to shoot at giant ants, and you end up like destroying a 33-story building because there was a spider on it. And you destroy the city to save the city. But I got it, and it was kind of fun. It's really glitchy, to the point that the menus are difficult to read, 'cause the fonts like overlap each other and stuff. And I saw it came up as that it was on sale, so I kind of bought it. And then when I was playing it, I was like, wow, that's a lot. This is kind of, I wonder if I've got some settings wrong or something. I'm going to go and see, check the community page. We'll see. In the community page, the top of it was like, 3 weeks ago, and it was an announcement from the developer saying, I'm very sorry, in very large letters with a lot of exclamation points, followed by a, I'm working really hard on this game. And it was very like, it was a lot of single person, like referring to themselves. I'm working really hard on this, and I know it crashes a lot. And I mean, this is all in very broken English, but trust me, I'm working on it. And that's the kind of game it is, but it's a lot of fun. And I've been playing Overwatch on PS4. Have you guys talked about that at all on your show?
I don't know if we talked about it. I know Jordan and Dylan played it.
Oh yeah, I think we talked about it. We talked about trying to convince Rob to get it, but that would require Rob going against his lifelong ban of Blizzard. So, unfortunately, right. We'll never get Rob into the Overwatch awesomeness. I still enjoy that game. I don't play it a lot. I play one or two matches a night. Just to get my get my dick wet, but that doesn't quite work. That's the antithesis of that. But
it's
a fun game. It's a game that you can jump in, play a few rounds. You can, if you feel like being offensive, you can play offensive. If you play like defense, you can play defense. You can do what you want. And I think there's a character for everybody in that game. You just need to find it. I'm really impressed with Overwatch.
No, I agree. I only play with a group of friends. You know, these are all like, you know, friends I know in real life that, you know, we'll get on once a week and play an evening of Overwatch. And yeah, I agree with you. It's fun and it's largely mindless. It's a good game to just hang out on headset. You know, it requires just enough communication to kind of pay attention. But also there's like a rhythm to it that allows you to, you know, just kind of chill while you're playing it, which I think is cool. And I wrote one other thing down. Oh, I'm playing my very first ever in my life Pokemon game.
Go? Pokemon Go?
No, not Go. Although I am playing Go. Barely playing Pokemon Go.
Well, some would argue that is the only way to play Pokemon Go is to barely play what barely is barely play. A game.
Yeah, I would agree with you on that. but no, I'm playing Pokemon Y on 3DS.
Okay.
And it's pretty good. I'm consistently impressed with one, how strong the production values are, I guess. You know what I mean? Like all the assets are really clean and crisp and everything. And I'm really impressed by that. And I also, I totally get why it's popular. It's both like incredibly simple. And then, you know, every time I look at the bottom screen, there's another like system or mini game or menu that I've never seen before that is, you know, a whole new avenue to like training and powering up my Pokemon. It's I'm constantly impressed at how deep it is for being a little handheld 3DS fighter that you can largely just press A to win. It's cool. Yeah, I've enjoyed it. That's it for me. That's basically what I've been playing.
Awesome, man. Well, thanks for the clue in. I've been playing Pokemon. I played Pokemon Red and Blue when they came out years ago as a kid.
Yeah.
But that's all I played in that realm. My wife really enjoys it, though. So if they're still getting good, are you looking at picking up the new ones that are coming out?
No, probably not. Not because I don't think they're going to be good, but because what made me decide to try Y was watching the videos that they showed at the E3 thing of the new ones, whatever they're called, Moon and Sun, and I was like, you know, that looks like the kind of game that I could sit on my couch and put on, you know, Star Trek Next Generation for just episode after episode after episode while just powering through this game on my 3DS on an afternoon. I was like, that looks like a game I could do a lot of that with. Maybe I'll buy one of the ones that's already out. So I bought Pokemon Y. And playing it, I'm like, okay, it looks identical to the one that I saw at E3.
Yeah.
So would I ever buy another Pokemon game again? Yeah, maybe. But I'll probably give them 7 or 8 generations till it looks a little different. You know what I mean? Before I do another one. They all look pretty much the same to me.
Yeah, I can see that, but at the same time, like if they just keep adding system after system after system, like at some point it's going to be like, "Oh, Pokemon, the impenetrable wall."
Yeah, you're very true, right? Like but I don't know. I mean, I feel like it's mostly manageable, you know. I don't know that, but I don't know how well I'm doing. I get lost a lot. That's another thing that I will say.
Wait, we are talking about Pokemon, not No Man's Sky, right? All those things that you just said could go towards that as well.
Could, yeah, exactly. Although, I feel a lot of times like I'm like, okay, now where is my objective? Or now I reached my objective, and then I backtrack to try and catch some Pokemon and level up, and now I don't know which direction I'm heading, and none of the NPCs are much help. That's what I find a lot. Actually, all those things could also be said about No Man's Sky.
Yeah, but I catch Pokemon all the time, actually. The procedurally generated Pokemon in No Man's Sky are fantastic. When you you touch down and like you don't know which Pokeball you have to use, it's right. Crazy.
Yeah, it's nuts. and then you upload them and there's some bizarre person out there who for some reason wants you to catalog every single creature that you see in your entire existence.
Indeed, so, and every plant. But we'll get more on that later.
It tells you when you miss some.
Rob, what have you been playing?
Couple things. I'm not going to talk about it, but I'm replaying the whole Deus Ex series just to have it all fresh in my mind for when Mankind Divided comes out next week.
That's already next week? Oh, my God.
Yep.
Holy shit, really? I thought that was, a couple weeks away at least. All right.
Yep, comes out the 23rd, I think, so...
Wow, yeah. I'm waiting. I've got my copy ordered.
Yeah, so really looking forward to that. It's like weird. There's been very little hype around it. I think they've really dropped the ball with the marketing. And anytime it shows up in the press, it's negative. So,
yeah.
So it's like someone said something stupid.
They probably should have augmented their PR thing.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm upgraded it in some way.
Yeah, some type of robotic implant
that auto tweets like 5,000 times a minute.
Yeah, which is five times faster than most people on Twitter can tweet.
Yeah, so
just five. Yes.
Yeah, but... and half as fast as Donald Trump.
Yeah, exactly. So, and just about as much good press as he's getting lately.
Yeah.
So that's a bummer, but I'm sure the game's going to be good. I mean, everyone who's actually played it raves about it, says they've really expanded the amount of choice in the game, and there are more consequences to all of your choices, which means there are more branching paths through the game.
I should go back, and I don't think I ever even finished Human Revolution.
I know I didn't.
Yeah, it's worth it.
But I like what I played of it.
Do they tie directly together? Is this a sequel to Human?
It's a direct sequel, yeah.
Fuck. That means I'm going to have to go and like look up a gameplay video.
Yeah.
I installed or not. No.
That's good.
Like, I installed it and the director's cut.
I mean, you could just play it. It's a really good game.
How long do you think it is?
The non-director's cut's probably 25 hours. Director's cut's probably 30.
Okay. That's doable if I focus on it.
Yeah. But it's a great game. You'll like it on the PC. I guarantee you.
Yeah, I just remember not liking it on the PlayStation when I got it on there. I don't know if it ran. I remember it running badly, but there was another problem that I had with it.
Only getting you guys for fractions of a second.
I'm sorry?
Well, we got you, so we'll...
Yeah, you're good.
Power through.
So anything else you've been playing other than Deus Ex?
Yeah, so Colin hit me up out of the blue and we started playing some games and we both picked up Destiny again. So, him for the first time, me, I reinstalled it. So, now that my expectations are way lower, it's enjoyable. You know, it's fun going in, doing those strike missions and all this stuff. We haven't gotten to all the new expansion pack stuff that I never played before, so I'm looking forward to doing the Taken King and whatever the other one after that is. But I forgot how good that game feels on the PS4. It really, they have the shooting fundamentals down really well, you know?
You tried to pull me back into that too, and I almost fell face first into it. But luckily, the lack of PlayStation Plus on my account stopped that.
Oh yeah,
I forgot that I hadn't played my PlayStation in how long? I mean, I think I went to go turn it on. I had to charge the headset and the controller, which I did, and then realized that I couldn't even play with you anyway. So. Jack looks very, very concerned where he's frozen right now.
we may have lost him.
Yeah, I think that might be the case, which this is going to get real interesting because this setup is made for three people.
He may be back.
There he goes. Now we're getting some blinking. But still very concerned.
Well,
we'll keep working on that.
Plugging through.
But... yeah, good game, good systems. Anything else?
No, really. It's just been No Man's Sky besides that.
All right. Well, I have been playing a game called We Happy Few, which I got for
I want to hear about this.
Now, everyone who I've... When that went live on Xbox and it went out, we got a review copy. And I enjoyed it. Granted, the beginning was what everyone had seen at E3. I hadn't seen it. I kind of stayed radio silent because I thought it was going to be interesting. What did that? That was really cool, really shocking. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, go see it on YouTube. I won't ruin it for you. Once you get into the game world, however, it's a completely different switch. It feels like a very, very different presentation of a game. But I differ from everybody else where I'm having fun with what they're doing, with what they've created in that bit. And I understand this is an early access thing. Like the different podcasts I listen to, the reviewers, stuff like that, they seem to not be really enjoying, what this is. And I think that they're looking at it from a much too closed a perspective, and that is that this is still a very, very early access game. They've even said, like, in the front, like, there's literally only one thing in here that is story. The rest of this is just mechanics. Just go play. Like, I mean, if you just have a game that's just mechanics, the game's not going to be good, right? Like, for the most part,
that's not always true.
No, but when you're setting it around a narrative, you know, when you start with a really strong narrative, and then you get that, like, that's gonna give some issues. But I enjoyed it, and what I've played of it, going through the first area, and then getting into the second space, I enjoyed what I saw, and I think the idea is very, very cool, and I think that I look forward to seeing what they come up with further iterations on that, and when the game actually comes out. I don't know when that's gonna be, but I do really like what they've put out. I've been watching it for a while, and bugging them to send something over so I can give it a try, but they finally gave in, and they're like, yeah, here you go. I was like, yay, sweet. So I gave it a shot, and I really enjoyed what I played. So, also been playing more Stellaris, which that is, of course, fun. I've been having a blast with that. But the cool thing here, did I tell you I'd gotten a Steam Link?
No. I want to hear about it, though.
So, yeah, I have a Steam Link. It is, for those of you who want to know, it is hardwired to my router. My PC has an AC1200 MUI-MIMO dongle. I think it's MUI-MIMO. No, sorry. The other dongle I have is MUI-MIMO. This is just an AC1200. But it works way better than I expected it to. I've been actually playing No Man's Sky using the Steam Link. So right now, as you see behind me, I'm in my office. And as you can probably see, if the stream is good, I'm sweating my balls off because it is hot here. And I do it for you guys, but there's a fan right here that I'm not using because it'll just blow out the audio. So when I'm playing games, when it's hot, I just go downstairs, turn on the Steam Link, connects in, right as rain, I can go. Cool thing is there's also a way that I can actually minimize the Steam Link so I can basically run my computer downstairs. So I have a mouse and a keyboard that I have that's connected to the Steam Link as well as a controller, and I just turn that on, I can control. It's absolutely fantastic. I'm enjoying it a lot.
Amazing.
I have had some weird hiccups where I'm using a tri-band router. So I have two 5 gigahertz channels and one 2.4 gigahertz channel. And I had to switch it to the 2.4 because the 5, it counts as one channel, but it oscillates between the two channels, but you only connect to one. So I couldn't actually connect to it on that level. And then there's some interesting things where I had a little bit of problem getting it started, but just read the forums, did a factory reset, and it updated to the latest firmware, and it went back on. So I was thrilled, and it has performed much better than I thought it would. There's a hair bit of latency on the controller and the mouse and keyboard, so it's not going to be for playing Overwatch or any competitive shooting games. In fact, I find it rather difficult to play a shooter in that with that little bit of latency. But I increased the amount of frames that were being processed, and that made it a lot better.
You know, I gotta say, I just got a Steam controller, and that is one thing that I can't do on a Steam controller is shooters. It's actually not great at those.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, because it uses the haptic feedback. The farther out you go, the faster it moves, right? So I imagine you...
You can set it. You can set that if you want it to. You can set any button to be just about anything. The customizability of it is really great. But it's like, either you get the trackpad of I don't know. It would be like, imagine playing a shooter on your laptop using your thumb as the trackpad.
Yeah.
Or on the trackpad to like try, like, it's really, you can get it really sensitive to where it feels like a mouse, like when you're looking around in like Skyrim or whatever. But when it gets to actually having to point your crosshairs at an enemy and fire and stay on that enemy as they move, turns out to be really, really difficult.
Yeah.
Unless you do a tremendous amount of tweaking.
They have a sort of a mouse roller ball setting for that as
yep.
a secondary,
yeah.
correct? How does that work?
Yeah, you can do trackball. You can set it up so it's more like a scroll ball. You can set it up like a mouse or like a trackpad. If you do mouse, you can change whether or not you want any acceleration to it based on how fast you swipe or not. You can do the same with both pads. Actually, you can set either one to be your mouse or your touchpad or anything like that. So I haven't actually worked with the track button yet. I haven't used that function too much. But I would assume it works similar to the joystick version, where you can just have it operate as a joystick instead, and it inputs like a mouse. It feels like a mouse, but it's actually sending it as a joystick. And that can be easy for when you're like, because in normal mode, if you just bring your hand all the way over to the corner of the trackpad, you can't really, you won't, if you hold it there, you won't continue to look right, like if you hold right on a controller, you know? So it's like,
it's amazing. After all the hype and hubbub and prototypes and everything about this thing, that it doesn't just work for everything. Because,
yeah,
even if they made it modular so you can click in some sticks for when you need them or something, like, because that's right. What the early patents led people to believe those things were going to be. It's like, man, I'd way rather just use a 360 controller at this point.
Yeah. And that's what I had to do when I bought the Steam controller, because I thought it would be a novel, fun thing to do while playing No Man's Sky. And shit, I mean, 20, 30 minutes with a Steam controller, I had to pick up my 360 controller, and that's what I played it with the entire time.
Gotcha. Yeah, and the 360 controller is what I've been using. But I did want to bring up here, since I do want to get into No Man's Sky conversation. I know, Rob, you need to get going here soon because you have the Wii one there, and that takes priority. But we usually have an unplugged section, and I wanted to kind of bring something here. You guys can see me, correct, here on that? You've got me pulled up there.
Yeah.
So when I last spoke, I had added some Hue lights and an Amazon Echo to my home to voice control those things. And then tied that to a Harmony so that I can turn on my living room lights and all that. Now, I've gotten even farther into it using something called Samsung SmartThings. And I thought this would be something fun to kind of give you guys an update on. So Samsung Smart Hub is a device that takes Wi-Fi enabled or Zigbee or Z-Wave enabled devices and allows them to all speak together. So now, at the touch of a button, I can hit this and I can say bada bing. And if you can see here, it'll adjust in a moment. I can see all of my house. I can see what's going on with the doors. I can see my windows. I can see
so
what's
can the
on.
Internet.
Yes, it's fantastic. Luckily, nothing there is damning. So it's fantastic. I can sit there and check everything. If I ever forgot to close my garage door, I installed it's called a MyQ by Chamberlain, so that I can remotely close my garage door. Like the locks, all that stuff is all so cool. I recommend everybody look into that stuff if you like having automated home stuff. So now my next step is I'm wanting to, I have motion sensors downstairs and I have them in every so far. I want to create if then statements that say like, oh, if there's no movement in this room, turn this light off to save energy. Or hey, if, or maybe you dim it and then you hold that dim for like a few minutes and then turn it off. So that way, if someone's actually there, they can just wave their hand and it'll turn back on. Sure. But, yeah, I thought that'd be kind of fun to talk about here. Cause I'm enjoying setting this whole system up, and soon I'll get these, luminescent sensors. Rob, you look like you're sitting there smirking. What are you thinking over there?
Oh, nothing. I'm not smirking at you. My dog's being a goofball. I actually think it's pretty cool. I mean, it's very like home of the future.
Right? Yeah, it's amazing to me how many different brands you mentioned in that like 2.5 minute explanation. Like how many different companies are like products are working together to make that happen. You know what I mean?
It's fantastic. Well, they created the medium called Z-Wave or Zigbee, which is a low wave Wi-Fi, I believe, that they can all communicate. And then you create these controllers that work together. So they created a standard, and then everyone can build to that, which is really cool.
That's awesome.
And there's developers creating different APKs or APIs. I can't remember which one is which. but new stuff comes out every day.
Sure.
And it's just a really, really, really cool system that you can add to and monitor everything. Soon, like if I wanted, I was looking it up. Like I could have sirens announced to it, and I could have... sorry, I'm paying attention to what's going on in this chat here. I was like, what?
Jordan's a terrible multitasker.
I am, especially when I see my video froze. What?
A text popped up.
Well, it's best because it's this way.
Never give this man cue cards.
No, Jordan, I'm never calling you again. I'm afraid you're going to be driving and just completely stop. Hello?
That's what earphones are for. You just kind of hit the button. But I just thought it was a cool system. I thought I'd update you guys whenever I add some stuff to that go.
I guess if that's how you react when two things occur at once, to have as many of those things as possible be located on the same menu would probably be a really good idea for you.
Yes, it's fantastic. But at this rate, let's go ahead and we'll get into No Man's Sky. But before we do that, I want to go ahead and add Mr. Ryan DeBrawl here, who's going to join this call. Let's see if everything just gets lit light on fire.
We're gonna go like it will. This.
Hopefully it doesn't light on fire. Now, I know everything's broken right now.
While you're readjusting, I have to run and do something very quickly. Okay, be right back.
We're going to go ahead and go to this image here. And it's time. Yes, Ryan, it is. It is, and he'll be coming on here momentarily, and then we'll get to the No Man's Sky conversation, which I'm kind of torn on this one, guys. I'm not gonna lie, I enjoy it, and from the mournful look on Jack Wefso's face right now,
mournful.
You're frozen, and you're frozen in such a way that you look very, very sad.
It's weird because I've got my video feed up here. I'm looking at myself on camera. I figured you just went to a still image when I started dropping in and out of the picture.
Nope. That's what's coming through on my end.
Okay. Well, I just turned it off and back on again. What about now? Scratching my beard for you there?
Yep. I see you. You are moving again.
Great.
And we'll switch back to this view here just to show Jack is not sad. He is just Jack.
No, not at all. We're here to talk about No Man's Sky. I'm actually pretty happy.
I love the fact Ryan asked me to give him a 5-minute warning. I gave him a 5-minute warning 6 minutes ago.
Well, you know, did he say thank you five? Did he?
Well, I don't know.
Give you the correct response back? Because, I mean, who knows if he heard you then?
That's true.
That's why you got to make him say thank you five.
Okay, so so you're saying it's still his fault?
Sure.
Okay, that's all I care about.
Right. Because it has to be someone's fault. That's the most important thing.
Exactly.
Is that it is somebody's fault.
Indeed. That's how society continues on. Like
it. That's how we work, man. That's how we do it.
That's why I blame Jordan for everything.
Right.
The baby just shit the bed. Fucking Jordan.
Fucking Jordan, man. This is a fucking nightmare. Get him on the phone. Get him on the fucking phone.
I'm trying to get Ryan on the phone, but he decided he's not picking up.
He's too busy playing No Man's Sky.
You know, he called me. I loaded up No Man's Sky. We'll preface this while we're waiting for him. And he calls me. He's like, talk to me in an hour and 45 minutes, and then we'll see if we're both going to send this game back.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, wow, that's a good way to start.
Great.
And he's like, the frame rate's locked at 30. It looks like garbage, this and that. So I'm like, okay, what? Okay, so I go in the settings, and I look at it, and I'm like, oh, there's options. And I click on the options, and I can't change any of the options. I'm like, what the hell?
Oh, because you're not holding down the button.
Yeah, but nowhere does it say you have to hold down every instance of a button to interact. Like, right. It went against everything. So
it gave you no instructions whatsoever. It gives you no instructions whatsoever on the PS4 version as well. The only reason I knew that was, I mean, if you've played Destiny, you know that's what's up.
Well, yeah, because they ripped the UI wholesale from Destiny.
Yeah, directly from Destiny. and I had watched enough gameplay videos to see that little circle fill over things. And I had spent the previous, two or three days before the PC release came out playing it on PS4. So you were able to change the settings eventually?
I was, actually. I got them changed to, like, max frame rate. I got them changed to higher resolutions, and it looks way better.
It's barely a port. Like, it's like they clicked export on export to PC.
That's exactly what Charles and I were saying my brother and I were saying at the bar yesterday. Yeah, it's like, did your programming have like an export to PC button? And you could choose, like, it had an export and you could either choose to like export it to PC or as a PDF. And you clicked PC and it just like sent it out, you know?
Yeah, with the same menus and the buttons work the same way. And
it's what it felt you like.
Bad port.
Well, and yeah, I mean, it's a terrible port. Like, people have been having bugs with it left and right. Luckily,
it's on my machine, and I have 24 gigs of RAM.
You have 24 gigs of RAM, and it runs like shit.
Yeah.
What kind of processor do you have? And why the fuck do you have 24 gigs of RAM?
Because I bought I went to double my RAM in preparation for No Man's Sky because I had the minimum amount of RAM, and I wanted more than that. I had 8 gigs and I was like, well, I'll just swap it out and I'll get, you know, I'll put 16 gigs of RAM in and it'll be great. I bought more RAM and I opened up my machine and my motherboard doesn't have 2 RAM slots. It has 4. So I just stuck it in next to my RAM that was already there. And now I have 24 gigs of RAM.
Did you pair those in the proper slots?
Yeah. I stuck them in there. It works.
Works. It turns on. That's what matters, right?
Yeah, exactly. It runs Far Cry 4 like amazing.
There you go.
It runs like ass on No Man's Sky.
What kind of processor are you running?
Oh, I don't know. And Rob, what did we put in it?
I don't remember.
I can look. I'm looking at my thing.
It was upper mid tier about 3 years ago. So it's getting up there in age a little bit. But he has a good video card. He's got a 650 Ti.
Yeah, although but the graphics aren't what's going to be the problem. It's the RAM and processor.
I've heard that a lot of people have said that the 600 cards are especially having problems with No Man's Sky. Okay. Vendor, where is it?
Well, I've been having problems myself with. Hey, look, Ryan is back.
Seer.
Hello.
Go ahead and get this fixed, and of course, everything broke. Fantastic.
Yay! Breaking.
Why is...
I remember at least one person before we did this saying that was going to occur.
That is indeed going to occur. That was Rob. I went through the fucking process of finding everything and getting it all set up. And then Skype decided that everyone is going to be in different positions. Bada boom. I can at least do that.
I don't know. I can't find my... I'm in my Steam information, but I can't find where it's... It doesn't... None of these say processor.
None of them say processor?
A lot of them say things that I don't know what they mean. CPU vendor, genuine Intel is what it says.
Genuine Intel?
It does make sense that, you know, that could be the bottleneck, because I would imagine the procedural generation stuff is quite the CPU hog. Most games aren't. Most games rely more on the GPU these days.
Right. Rob, didn't you tell me to download a program that would give me all that information?
Yeah, I think I told you it was CPU-Z, maybe?
Yep, that's it. Grab it here.
So, Ryan.
Yes?
How is the how's the world? It's been a while since we've had you on the Game Out Loud.
Yeah, well, I think it's been a while since you guys had a Game Out Loud podcast.
Oh!
this is true. I blame you. You constantly shame me and make me and cyber bully me to not doing a podcast. In fact, I didn't do the podcast because I quote, "You are a terrible individual who should never do podcasts." That was the last thing you said to me, and it really hurt my feelers.
Wow. Yeah. Really.
It doesn't sound like you took my advice though.
Yeah. Yeah. I really went for the jugular.
So.
But
what's going on, guys?
We are actually just getting ready to talk about our No Man's Sky conversation here.
Oh, well, I mean,
talk about
save some time. First. 10 out of 10 blew my expectations out of the water. Go out and buy it.
Are you?
There we go.
I give it 14 quintillion stars.
Yes, yeah. That's right. And I'm going to see every one of them. That's how long I'm going to be playing this game. I mean, what do you need any other game for now? I've got the game to play for the rest of my life.
Forever.
Infinite content, infinite opportunities for exploration, infinite like discovery. It's everything everybody's ever wanted in a video game. I mean, really, we put it on a pedestal while it was under development, and I don't think we raised that pedestal high enough. I mean, honestly.
Yeah.
A narrative that rivals Half-Life 2.
Yeah,
for game, each planet.
Gameplay that's iconic beyond any game that we've ever had before.
It's true.
Yeah, every promise fulfilled.
Handcrafted for all of us.
Oh yeah, I mean the like mythos and pathos behind every single world and how it's got this whole like backstory and how it all ties into this grander scheme. It's really, I mean, it was I had religious, like, feelings about this game.
Sure. Let me ask you a question. Were you expecting every world to have its own mythos and, like, reason for being and storyline behind it based on what you saw in any of the material leading up to it? Like, was that something that you were going into this game expecting?
No, not really. I mean, if cut the crap for a second, what I really expected was a vibrant world populated with interesting things to see and, spore-like generated creatures. What we get is hundreds and hundreds of barren rocks with little rat creatures running around once in a while. And that's not 100% of the time after...
I don't know. How many planets have you been to?
I'm thinking around 30 or 40 by now. I've made 20 warp jumps and, you know, explored planets.
Do you land on every planet in every system?
No.
Okay. Yeah.
Nope.
All right. I have seen a lot of the things that you're talking about. I've seen, like, massive creatures that fly through the air. I've seen huge-ass dinosaurs. I've seen, like, crazy little bipeds. I've seen a lot of variety. I haven't seen any fish, which is kind of interesting.
It seems a bit fishy to me.
I have seen plenty of barren rocks. Mm-hmm. That's for sure. In most systems, most planets are barren rocks, which is kind of cool. It's kind of like space. But I mean, I definitely think, like, a lot of times I see two species on a planet, and I'm like, oh, look, they are identical, except for one has feet with toes and one has hooves.
Right.
You know what I mean? And that can be a disappointment. But I have also seen a tremendous amount of variety in that game.
I actually was ready to give up on the game pretty much until you called me. I couldn't get over the hump, like, okay, I played this for an hour and 50 minutes. This is a joke. I mean, this was accomplished better by Minecraft 5 years ago. Like, why?
Minecraft, you know, sucked when it came out, though, dude. You know, like, and it was made by one guy, you know. Now, granted, they didn't charge us $60 for Minecraft.
Right. Right.
You know what I mean? Which is definitely a point to be made. But I understand what you're, yeah, like, Minecraft had that whole procedural generation, and I guess I agree with that sentiment to an extent. I think it, you know, I don't know. It does kind of reek of early access a little bit, though.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think anybody who just starts the game and plays for the first couple hours is probably going to have a negative experience, because I mean it's got a slow learning curve. It's got, you know, it takes a while for it to get up to speed, and once it does get up to speed, it seems repetitive and boring. Like, once you understand what you're doing, where you are in the universe, and why you're there, and what the developers intended you to do, it makes you wonder, like, Should I do this? I don't know if this is worth doing or not, because, you know, you start off in the game and, you know, I'm very torn about this game. I mean, don't get me wrong. You know, I was sarcastic before. I don't hate the game. I certainly don't hate the game, but I'm not in love with the game. I haven't given up on it completely, but it's got, you know, I hate to be so, it's got so much potential that it, you know, that it didn't live up to, but you start the game, and I did like the fact that it was show, don't tell. You know, they didn't, like, say, walk forward. You're like, okay, gee whiz, I can walk around, now what I do? Oh, if I click on this, it gives me a thing. What does that mean? Oh, look, Destiny's menu system. I really missed that. You know? Yeah. But then you start to understand a little better. It's like, oh, okay, that's kind of neat how, like, all the plants have carbon in them. They're carbon-based. That, I like that. Yeah. I get on board with that. And how this refills, you know, this, the red stuff refills this, and the green stuff refills that. And eventually, I think, within an hour, I got 58 minutes. I got lucky. You know, I didn't get stuck on a barren rock or anything like that. I was able to take off towards my first planet. I'm like, oh, this is going to be good. And at the time, I was actually using the mouse and keyboard as a controller, because it is a PC game.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
And as soon as I started flying around, it's like, what the fuck is this shit?
What the shit is this? Yeah.
Because it uses the World War I airplane ride, where it's like, oh, I want to turn.
It's like, yeah, totally.
And then Jordan's like, I'm not getting that at all. It's like, oh, okay. So I cracked out the Xbox controller, and sure enough, oh yeah, it actually controls like a video game now. Wonderful.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I thought I was.
Oh yeah. I was blown away. I was on the forums, like, I was like, I've used the mouse. I've used a Steam controller. I've been playing this game for 3 days on PS4. How the fuck do I look around my cockpit?
Yeah.
And everybody's like, yeah, I don't think it works. And somebody else is like, turn on your Xbox controller, and that'll work. And I was like, oh, son of a bitch. All right. Well, there you go. Yeah.
Game is more
bad.
Certainly
bad port. I will agree.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't even know if there is a melee button on the keyboard. It's certainly nowhere I could find
it.
But
it's Q.
Q. Yeah.
Q.
It's
like, is it really?
Yeah. I went through and looked. Okay. I was like, oh, who the fuck designed these? Like,
right.
That's your melee. Although I will say, on the controller, the fact that roll is your right bumpers, that are your bumpers, that's a little weird for me. Like, I expected.
Oh, really?
I expected it to be World War standard. World War,
yeah,
plane style, where I would use my right thumbstick thumbstick for altitude and list, and then right thumbstick would be pan and roll.
Pitch.
Right.
Pitch and roll, yeah. Like, that's
well, that was exactly the problem with the keyboard controls, though. It did. It controlled like a World War I biplane. It's like, what is this?
Yeah. So. Yeah, it was, yeah, there's a lot.
they needed to control, like, Strike Suit Zero or something, if they were going to have it be mouse and keyboard. I think that would work a little better. Strike Two Zero was one where you kind of drug it across and it followed your mouse, right?
Yeah, no, they've been doing that since Freelancer came out in early 2000, where they're you throw your cursor outside of the little center circle, and then with slight delay, your camera like realigns to where your cursor is, and you throw it outside the circle, and it follows it. So it's got a very I always called it the fish lure type camera, where you like. Boop, and it goes like, and you boop, so you follow it along. You pull in the camera on a little piece of string, and that works very well because you get that slight delay, and it allows you to do something like yank it real fast, and you can watch yourself, follow it back around very, very smooth. So that one-to-one camera stuff, I mean, it's like I said, it's the first time I noticed it was in Freelancer, and ever since then, I notice whenever it's not that whole one-to-one like. Mm-hmm. Doesn't work as well, but I didn't really have a problem once I switched the controller with the way the ship controls. Well, except for all the shitty design choices they make, like the complete lack of impact with the terrain, the fact that you can't look down when you're landing, the fact that I landed on top of a tree, almost fell out of the indestructible tree, and invalidated my entire game.
The very first time I spawned on this planet, gorgeous jungle planet, all these like crazy creatures all over it, and it's got these giant floating asteroids, right? Mm-hmm. That like hover in there. They're huge, right? And so the very first time I get my ship all powered up and I get it to take off, I'm like, all right, here we go. And I take off and I cruise for a little while, like through the atmosphere, and I'm like, look at that massive floating asteroid rock over there. I'm gonna land on that thing and like walk around. And I land on it, and it's the size of a fucking football field, man. It's huge. And there's like these layered steps in it, and everything. It's completely barren, right? And I go and I like get back in my ship, and I'm like, okay, take off. And it's like, you don't have enough fuel to live.
No
way.
And I was like, what? Wait, what? And it was like, no, you don't have enough fuel for that. And I was like, well, refuel. You don't have any plutonium. And I was like, what? So I wandered around on this rock that's just a fucking floating rock for, I don't know, like 30, 40 minutes trying to come up with a solution. Couldn't find one. Ended up jumping off of it and using my jetpack to break my fall back down. And then I walked for 3 hours across the surface of the planet until I found enough resources to sell and found a vendor who was selling bypass chips, and then was able to use a bypass chip to summon my ship to that location. And you know what? For me, that was the perfect adventure to like start No Man's Sky for me. I was like, I'm stranded.
You sound a bit like an apologist. That's called bad gameplay mechanics. You know,
that was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed it.
I'm with Jack on this one. Once I discovered that you could go to those platforms, build an unlock chip, and beam your ship to you, I got a lot more positive on the game. Because before it was like, I want to go and be able to fuck off and explore, but I don't want to have to walk back to my ship. Right. I want to be able to find a place.
Well, you still have to find one of those beacons.
Another thing is like you were talking about the show don't tell. If I had bothered to look a little bit closer at my crafting inventory, I would have seen that I already knew how to make bypass chips.
Yeah,
and that bypass and chips.
Plutonium.
Yeah, and bypass chips are nothing but iron and plutonium, which are present on every frickin' planet. Mm-hmm. And instead, I didn't realize that. And I just kind of kept walking until I found a vendor who happened to be selling bypass chips. And then I went out and farmed until I had enough to buy it. And then I walked out to the platform. And then when I got in my ship and flew it around, it was like infinitely more rewarding for me. I mean, I will freely admit that I do love this game and have so many criticisms of it. But at the end of the day, I feel like I got exactly what the developers told me I was going to get.
So,
except
that's what I
say. We'll get to the except here in a bit, but I want to give you my starting here, and that is that I started lush, beautiful planet, fucking gorgeous area, fantastic, but I was having a friend come over to play with me, so I hit okay, exit, waited for him to come over because I just wanted to make sure it ran. Loaded back in, it didn't save. I was on a fucking hell planet with radiation everywhere. Fucking with heat destroying everything. So I was constantly trying to keep my thermal protection up, my life signs up. Like, it was rough. Yeah. Well, I would find large deposits of like things that I could mine and mine my own cave to like get my stuff back up. So
mine down.
Yeah. So get in there and get a space to hide. Now I went and there was plutonium everywhere. So I stocked up, like did a lot of that, sold a lot of it to get a lot of stuff. So I needed to fix my ship. Was like, great. Just kept enough plutonium to like power some stuff. I was like, sweet. Jumped up, went to another planet, touched down. I was like, ooh, this one's way different. This one's all like wavy with like grass and like different atmosphere and everything. I'm like, oh, sweet. I just touched down randomly. Let's go ahead and fly around. Go to get up, fly. Okay, we're going. Oh, a little settlement. Sweet. Sit down. It's one of those settlements that has absolutely nothing in it. Like, it's just a building that doesn't actually have anything or entrances or anything.
Two little, like, rectangular, like, buildings or, like,
Yeah.
I know the one you're talking about, yeah.
So, I'm like, oh, well, that's dumb. Go to get in my ship. Go to take off. Oh, your launch thrusters don't have enough fuel.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, so I go and this is, like, the first time I've had to refuel those. Misclicked. Used the plutonium to charge my gun instead of the carbon. And this place had carbon galore.
Yeah.
It literally took me 4 hours to find enough plutonium to launch.
That's ridiculous.
Like,
I've never had an issue
hunting around.
Yeah, it's everywhere. It, like, a lot of times I will have to walk over a couple of hills, but, you know, from my ship, but then I'll find a big patch of it. Yeah, that's great. Did you scan for it? Did you use your...
Every,
of course you did.
Every one that came like up was Thamian 9. Which is, I need
which
that too.
Which is harder to find on the surfaces. Yeah.
So I found
seas
of that
stuff. But then in space, they
stuff.
Put it every 5 fucking meters. You know what I mean? Yeah. Yeah.
So I sat there hunting. Eventually got up. I will never have anything less than a full set of platinum or plutonium with me when I go anywhere. Now, how much money do you guys carry around with you on average?
Oh, dude, I'm constantly like I've gotten really good at flying really slow over the surface of planets and like picking out the temples and the drop pods that give you extra suit inventories. So a lot of times I'll just cruise over and I'll just and you know, and those go up by I think 10 grand for every suit slot that you buy. The last one I bought cost me 100,000.
Nice. That's where I'm at too.
I think the most money I've ever carried at once was like 300,000.
Oh, okay.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm at like, but I'm at 1.3 right now, million.
Oh, yeah. I also don't do a lot of just like mining just to sell.
I do.
and I also use a lot of my, and this is a whole other fucking thing we can talk about, probably my biggest criticism of the game, which is why the fuck are my life support systems and my suit upgrades taking away my fucking inventory? Right. It drives me insane. And if you want a badass ship, you can't carry anything in it. You know, and like it, I just it would be easy. It would be easy to fix. Right now, your menu has multi-tool, suit, and ship. It needs to have multi-tool, suit, ship, and pack.
Inventory. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, there you go. Just to, you know what I mean? And maybe your backpack, maybe upgrading your jetpack reduces your inventory by a small amount or something like that. You know what I mean? But like your inventory needs to be separated out from that.
There are multiple like bizarre design choices.
Yes. I agree with you. Yeah.
And they seem to have like no like sense of reason. Like maybe I don't know, focus group.
It's artificial lengthening. How hard? Like
maybe that is.
You'd be able to fucking build whatever. You'd be able to carry enough to buy whatever the fuck you wanted. You'd be able to have everything else. You could have multiple warp cells just hanging out instead of having it be scarcity.
Yeah.
As an example, why can you only have one ship?
That's the same thing. Yeah, but I figure with them saying that base building is coming in an upcoming update, you'd have to think that having multiple ships would, like, by necessity be part of that. So you'd have a place to park your shit. Otherwise, what's a base for except to put your shit in? You know what I mean? Like,
where you store your emeralds and your iron and your zinc.
I think Jordan's here on the right. You're on
and
the
I
right.
T- I take that. I want a fucking bank. I want a bank so bad. I've got stuff that I know I'm gonna need down the line. I've got stuff that's gonna be great, but I don't need it right now, and it's taking up inventory room. So what do I do with it? I sell it, or
sell zinc, and then on the next planet, I'm like, great. Now I need to find fucking 10 zinc flowers.
Right.
Before build a square out of wood in Minecraft, you got a treasure chest like that. It's like the third thing you learn.
Yeah.
And yet it doesn't even exist in this game.
Well, this doesn't have any external crafting yet. It's all internal.
The game doesn't feel like it was playtested a lot. And I think that speaks to the fact that it really is an indie game.
Yeah.
And they're trying to get away with asking AAA prices, which I think if I'd paid $20 for this game, I'd be raving about it.
Oh, yeah.
As it is, I'm having fun, but I don't feel like I spent $60 on it.
Yeah, it smacks of early access, and Rob and I were talking a little earlier today before the podcast started about, you know, comparisons to Ark or like DayZ, you know, which, I mean, I put 200 hours into DayZ and it's still not out of alpha 2 years later, you know, and so I definitely have had my enjoyment of those games, but it is a little strange and a little maybe disappointing that this feels more like that than it does like.
Oh, I think the game could have benefited tremendously from another year of development. I was saying to Jordan the other day, I think we all just became aware of its existence too soon.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if this was a December 2017 title, this would be AAA material, because you can tell that there was a lot of love put in this game. I mean, for an indie game, it doesn't feel very much like an indie game. It feels like a bare bones AAA game that's not done being made yet.
Oh yeah, they are just a small team. They did have Sony helping publish, like they helped them somehow that way. But I think that's the problem, is they got tied to Sony. Sony got the hype train going because that's what publishers do.
And what else did Sony have? Sony didn't really have a lot at the time. I mean, they announced it in that year of amazing trailers, like when Shenmue and all those other things got announced. But that was the year where it was all amazing announcements, but none of those games were coming within the next year or 2 years. You know what I mean? Like, it was all like, oh, cool, 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 but way down the fucking line. And I think this is one of the first of those. That's kind of, I mean, Last Guardian is what, in 2 months, you know, like this is the first of those announced titles actually starting to drop. And I think you may be right. I think that we may have been made aware of it too soon. And, you know, and another reason that it reminds me of DayZ and of Ark is there is a lot of me that's like, you know, imagine what it's going to look like in 3 years, you know, if they support it that long.
Well, they need to pull a Valve and continuously develop this game now that it's out, especially now that it's the biggest PC launch of the year.
Yeah, they
well,
have so much
Steam
money.
Launch anyway.
Well, yeah, you know what I mean? They own the IP. Sony does not. So they got that. I mean, they had to pay Sony, you know, for their help, but I'm sure they made bank. And they need to support something like this, especially like I've got my roommate here was arguing that he's like, oh, I think they're going to go under. I think this might go, oh, fuck. No, they're not. Like they made a lot of money.
No.
They have to support this thing.
That what's his name who made this is a multi-millionaire now.
Yeah,
there's 15 people at the company. They just sold like 3 million copies at launch.
This is a Batman versus Superman and Suicide Squad situation where everybody who paid for it don't like it, but they paid for it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
I'm not going to say that I don't like it. I'm having a blast.
Yeah, I'm
pessimistic about it, but there are some very interesting things. I think the strongest oddly, for a game that's not who's the developers? Where? What country?
Hello
are they?
Games from UK.
Oh, they're UK.
They're UK. Okay, so
yeah,
it is.
That's why when
I thought they were Scandinavian or something. It's like this is really quite talented writing. Like it's really good. Anytime you run into something and it's got a blurb, you know, which is literally everything. That's your only interaction are these little blurbs. Some of those like virus abandoned.
Yeah, oh, are really cool.
Or like, they're haunting. They're like Lovecraftian in their nature. Like, I stared into its eye and it stared back at me, and I thought for a moment, am I watching it or is it watching me? You know?
Yeah, all those kind of cool things. Yeah, no, I agree. Those are neat. And they said in their day one patch notes that large sections of one of the branches of dialogue were like largely rewritten in the day one patch. Like somebody, I can't remember, some other video game writer or something came in and rewrote a whole bunch of the dialogue concerning like Atlas Path or something like that. I can't remember. It's in the patch notes.
Man, these patches, they need to get a fucking handle on that shit. Like when Sean Murray is sitting there going, the game that is you're playing is not the game. Like the game on the disc is not the game. What about people who live in Alaska who have fucking 1 kilobyte a month available for their download?
Well, did you hear? That was the reason that they gave for delaying Final Fantasy 15 today. You guys heard about that?
Mm-mm.
They pushed the delay back from September 30th to November 30th. It is literally exactly what happened to No Man's Sky, including the complete, like it first got leaked by Kotaku that maybe it was getting delayed. This was a couple days ago. And then everybody denied it. And a bunch of people posted on the internet that they called 30 GameStops and that all the GameStops said it was still coming on the. And then, I mean, this is like note for note exactly what happened in No Man's Sky. And then GameStop employees started posting pictures of the new release dates and the instructions to paste over the old release date. And then other people said that it still wasn't happening. And then finally the developers came out and announced that it was exactly the same length of delay, like 2 month delay. It's hilarious to watch the whole message board burn down as if this did not just happen with No Man's Sky. But anyway.
And I look forward to the entire internet being disappointed with Final Fantasy 15 as well.
Yeah, exactly.
Because
right?
We all know that's what's going to fucking happen.
A 600-person team.
Over 10 years.
You nailed it, Jack. That's exactly what's wrong with that game. It's like, everybody in a small town worked on this game. So it's got a singular vision. It's like, are you sure? You license Gucci's shoes? Like, it's such a... and a full length movie along with it, with a theatrical release, Kingsglaive. Go and see Kingsglaive, and then...
Tell me it's fucking nothing, because you will have forgotten all about it by the time the movie comes out another 2 months. But they delayed it, and the reason that they said they delayed it, that's why I brought it up, Jordan, was that Tabata said in his thing, he was like, we want everybody to play and enjoy it, and we don't want to have to do a massive day one patch because some people don't really have very good internet. So instead, we're going to delay it for everyone and put the patch on the disc.
Good. Good for them. Like, that shit needs to be standard. Remember when that's how things were? Like, the game you got... Like, day one worked and was the game?
I just remember it was just broken forever unless you downloaded it to a floppy disk. And there'd be, like, one patch on Usenet.
No, I remember patches used to be 30 megabyte files you got out on internet. You had to learn what a zip file was and how to drop files on top of existing directory structures, you know?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Patch notes.
No executions, no executables, just...
No, no executables. There was nothing like that.
The better thing they would do is just not announce that the second batch of games had the patch in it, and it would still be the same version and everything, so, like, the first 100,000 people to buy a game would just have the broken version and never know.
That's right. 1.01? I don't get it. What does that mean?
What is... Yeah.
101% better?
Well, I gotta get it, then.
But yeah, No Man's Sky has been a very weird one. It's one that I think a lot of people have been looking forward to. It's an indie game that's infinitely procedurally generated. And I think people forget that first aspect, that it is an indie game. It's a small game. I mean, I went into this with...
Well, with indie hopeful... game for AAA prices.
Yeah. So.
And how can you call it an indie game if it's published by Sony? That doesn't sound very indie.
Well, it wasn't created by Sony, though.
Was it published by Sony?
I thought it was published on the PS4. It was published by Sony, self-published on the PC.
Oh, okay.
Which explains why the PC version is clearly inferior.
Yeah, Sony.
Is it? I only have my experiences from the PC, but people are saying
I own both the PS4 and PC versions, and it is a infinitely better and more enjoyable experience on the PC. There is no stuttering. There is no slowdown on the PS4. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay.
Damn.
Okay. Oh, no, no, my, yeah, my bad. Sorry. Okay. There is no stuttering. There is no slowdown on the PS4. It is, like, I play the PC version. I played it a lot so that I could talk about both of them on this. And usually when I sit down to play, I start on the PC version. After about 45 to 50 minutes, my slowdown is so much that I turn it off. I go to the PS4 version, and I play that for hours and hours on end.
Yeah, see, I haven't had that bad of a problem. I have a little bit of slowdown every once in a while, but... My run's like ass.
I have a couple scenarios. I wonder if you guys have encountered this, because I don't know if it's it's so bizarre. One is, have you experienced the super liftoff, where if you hold E, where you'll just boom, go 200 miles in the air.
Yeah, and you kind of
and now you're in space.
You're like, when you get there, you're like kind of like randomly like kicked around.
Yeah.
I've had that happen.
Have you had that happen when you go and do one of the activations of one of the bases and it does the pan out, except for you hit A at the same time and your entire character with gun and everything shoots through the roof and goes into the stratosphere?
I saw some videos of this. It was really funny. And then you end up landing like 200 miles away and you have to walk back to your ship.
That's what happened to me. Yep. Like,
That's amazing.
Yep, I had that happen. Then I had it actually deposit me back inside. But that view goes up, you look, and then it comes down into the thing. I was locked on top of the building, like gun and everything, just sitting there. Couldn't move, had to restart.
Wow.
I warped into a system. Actually, while I was on Skype with Rob, I warped into a system. This was on PC, and like the very first thing, as soon as I came out of hyperspace, I slammed into the side of the space station and went like bing, and just like ricocheting off, like spinning around in space. It took me a minute to figure out what had happened, because the very first thing that happened was like impact right with the side of a space station right when I came out of warp.
Which, yeah, I wish that would have killed you, not gonna lie. Like, anyway,
I haven't died yet. I have died a couple of times, almost all in space
combat. Yep,
which is really difficult for me.
I would say lackluster and bare bones.
Yeah, that as well. At least in Elite Dangerous, I can send pips to my weapons and back to my shields, and you know what I mean. I feel like I
You have variety. You have variety in Elite Dangerous, and when I looked at their system, and they had all these augments for your ship, for your multi tool, for all this stuff, I was like, oh. So I can augment this thing so I can have I can have as many slots as I can get, but I can really make this thing mine. Except for no, you can't.
Right.
You have a mining laser, you've got a bolt shooter, and you've got a rocket launcher. Now, I did find a shotgun attachment that you can get, but there is not nearly enough variety for what that is supposed to be for me to be multi-tool. Like, ooh, yeah.
I agree. Not very multi.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
No, I mean, combat is, I mean, I don't know. Maybe it gets, I have run into one laser dog, which that was surprising. That's the most threatening. I don't think most of the animals, you know, they just skitter away from you, even the very, very large ones. Yeah. But yeah, I've run into one laser dog, and the rest of it is, you know, lob a grenade at the, I fear nothing. You know what I mean? Those sentinels, they take pictures of you. It's like, eh.
Yeah, the only creature that has ever really had me worried that I wasn't going to be able to beat it in time was also the smallest creature that has ever attacked me. And it was this little, like, he ran on two legs. He looked like the, what are they called in Fallout New Vegas?
The Deathclaws?
The geckos?
The geckos. It looked like a little gecko, except imagine one of those. But he was, I'm not shitting you, he was like 6 inches tall. I could barely see him. It took me a minute to figure out what was damaging me. And he was fucking fierce, dude. And he just like charged at me, and he was just biting at my ankles, and I couldn't quite get a handle on him, and he ran faster than me. So I was like, I'm running backwards. I was like trying to shoot at him. But for the most part, I have not detected, you know, I haven't seen massive predators that, I've never been scared. I have never been really.
I got threatened and almost died from a fish.
Really? I haven't seen any fish yet.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I forgot. We were talking about this. I have seen fish, by the way. They're big and mean, and I kill them.
Yeah.
At least on my planet, they're these giant, like, carnivorous tiger fish. Like, they're sharks. They're huge.
Oh, and I jumped. That's so cool.
I was on this one planet that all the ruins...
Yeah.
Here's a glitch. It would populate ruins. The ruins were all, one, underwater. Two, didn't populate, because I don't know if it's because they were underwater or not, but they were big open areas where you could tell they wanted something to be there. There was nothing there. But one of them was in the middle of the ocean. So I was like, oh, okay, I'll just swim out there. I'll try this once. And then I swam all the way out there, swam down to the bottom, nothing there. And then this gigantic shark comes swimming at me, and I'm like, yeah, because you can't run in water. You have to try to use your jetpack to get as high out so they don't get you. And then I'm running the whole way. I didn't die, luckily, but my jetpack kept me far enough ahead. But there was a glitch where the ruin was not in where it was supposed to be. So I left that planet. I did three of them. They were all underwater. None of them were there. Like nothing
were there.
Was rewarding me there.
Yeah.
So left the planet. How many slots, Jack, since I think you're the one who put the most time in, how many slots is your multi-tool by now?
My multi-tool is 19 slots.
Okay, you got one.
Or maybe 20. And my ship is like 23 or 24.
Okay.
So
you're getting up there. My ship is still the same.
Yeah,
but
I bought a ship and then immediately found a ship right after I had blown all my fucking cash on a ship.
I did that with several multi-tools.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So now I've just taken to not, and now I've also learned that, I've learned how to look for abandoned ships, and I've also learned that, every abandoned ship that you find will always be one slot better than the ship you're currently driving.
Same thing with multi-tools. So when you go into the
base, what happened to me?
Then you go and you get the multi-tool, like, and does that.
Yeah, it's been proven. People are checking in with each other on the message boards and stuff, being like, has anybody found? I did find a multi-tool with two slots more.
That's what
than the multi-tool that I found. But ships, I have only found, and universally, at least from what I've seen on the web, everybody's like, yeah, I find a lot of abandoned ships, but they only ever have one more slot than the ship that you're currently flying.
I found one that did not have any improvement whatsoever.
Yeah, I found one that was one slot less than the ship that I was currently flying as well.
That's awesome. Rob, you haven't really piped in all that much in this conversation. I thought I'd hear more out of you.
Well, I don't know. I mean, the thing is, the game is so huge, and even though I've played, 6 hours of it, I feel like I haven't seen most of it. The one thing I do want to say that really helps a lot, and I know, Jack, you agree with this because I got your text about it, playing your own music and just kind of chilling out is the way to do it. I mean, if you treat it as a vaguely interactive screensaver that lets you, or like a visualizer for your music,
put that on the box. Vaguely interactive screensaver by Hello Games.
But that's the most fun I had with it, was just putting on really good music and just kind of wandering around and exploring and having fun.
I had a lot of prog rock and that's what I did. A lot of Bowie and Queen and shit like that. And just cruised through space listening to that stuff. And yeah, exactly the same thing. Like, I just kind of meander through that. Through that game.
I actually, when I booted it up, when I was playing just on my own, I started off by playing When Worlds Collide by Power Man 5000.
Nice. Excellent.
Yeah. That's my nerdness for that one. I couldn't think of anything else to play. I guess I could have played the soundtrack to 2001, but
I have that. I have that in there. I dumped a lot. I made a massive playlist, and I dumped a lot of like space movies. So I have the whole soundtrack to 2001. I put the soundtrack to Interstellar in there. Nice. I put the soundtrack to the first Mass Effect game. Just lots of like space music, and then the other side of it is a lot of like prog rock and shit. A lot of Rush.
What you need to do is you need to put the fucking the soundtrack for Event Horizon in there every once in a while. So you're riding around in space, and then you just get horror. Like, you're like, oh, God.
Yeah.
Did I just jump to the other side of hell? Did I just fold space? What did I bring back with me? I don't need my eyes.
Yeah, that would work if the game was scary at all in any way, ever.
I'm just hoping that I'm just hoping that as I get deeper, and I really take my time. I stop on every planet and every system, at least to, like, stop, look around, name it. I'm hoping that as we get farther and farther, we'll see crazier and crazier shit and scarier shit. Fingers crossed. Or maybe after a couple of updates, we'll see scary shit. You know? Right.
Well, let's get some final thoughts here. I'm going to go ahead and start off by saying the reason I bought it on PC is because even if it was not going to be the game at launch that everyone wants it to be, the PC at least has a more open platform for having mods added to this thing. Now, at the same time, now that I've thought about it and I see how this game works, I'm not sure how mods are going to go due to the fact that it hits a fucking server every 30 seconds to update what you've done. So that might put that dead in the water. But I'm really hoping that mods come through, because then we could have something like they've created the egg that people can work and make some amazing things with this procedurally generated world or this universe. So I'm hopefully optimistic. I don't think the game is ready. I don't think it was ready, just like everyone else was saying. But I do think that there is something there that can be used to build something fantastic, and that we'll see how it goes. I mean, it's really going to be up to Hello Games from this point on to see how they support that and what they do with that. So, Ryan, your closing thoughts on No Man's Sky.
I think they built an interesting engine and then had to put a game on top of it to hit a release date. And I don't think it's really where it needs to be satisfactory by and large. I mean, I think a lot of the positive comments are us wishing for things to come. You know, the potential is definitely there. You know, it has potential, but when it comes right down to it, there's not a whole lot of gameplay there. I wish I had been, you know, a little. I wish I had gotten it on sale. I wish I had gotten it 6 months from now when there's something worth playing. But I bought it now, so by the time it's a full product, it'll be in my, you know, my rearview mirror. So.
Oh, so thanks for mentioning that, because that's a really weird way to store games.
In your rear,
rear. But no, it's not all bad. It's an enjoyable game, in a limited sort of way. It's like a warm bowl of chicken broth. Does it fill you up?
I say so. No. It's really really good. But then you like after you're done with it,
you wish
like,
there was chicken empty. In it.
Yeah.
Yeah. There you go. I wish there was some chicken in my soup, but I got flavored water.
All right. Well, thank you, Ryan. Rob, your closing thoughts?
Maybe next time don't do a bunch of interviews and say you can bump into each other. It's just really unlikely when you actually just can't bump into each other, even if you go to the same spot at the same time.
I'm sorry. We gotta discuss this shit. No one's brought this up. That guy, like we were talking about this earlier, that guy basically made some bold-faced lies about how this game is going to work, right? Like
have they pulled apart the PC version would be where to go to look to see if there's any netcode in it. And I haven't seen anybody look to see.
They did a poop out of it. There's a poop.
So, okay. Well, there you go. It should be in there, right? Somewhere in those folders, we should be able to tell right away whether or not it's sending location data to the server, which is the basic function of giving us multiplayer. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know what to think. I really don't at this point. It seems. I'll just say that, and this will be my closing thought part of it as well. Is that I don't get hyped for video games. I'm not a big hype guy, and I haven't been this excited for a game in years. I've been waiting for No Man's Sky since the moment it was released. Maybe Skyrim. I was this excited for. I mean, I bought it on two different platforms. You know, I was super pumped on this game, and I agree with everything that you guys have said about it. I really, really do. Every word you guys have said. And that said, I love it, and I'm probably gonna play it when I get off. When I get off of this call. Like it's everything. I got everything that they told me I was going to get, with that one exception, which makes me think to mention it so much. And for me to largely get everything else that he said I was going to get, even in skeletal form, it just, I don't know. I have trouble buying that it wasn't maybe a server overload or some kind of glitch. But then again, they're notoriously bad at communicating with the public. And I have been as a developer since the day they announced this game. So who fucking knows?
And with that, we're going to go ahead and say good night to you folks. Thank you very much for listening in. Jack Wefso's positive, uplifting statements can be found on many of our podcasts, which you can find at GameOutLoudPodcast.com. If you want to send in the hate mail, you can go ahead and send that to Jack Wefso at GameOutLoudPodcast.com.
The good please stuff, send me the hate mail.
Yes, the good stuff you can just send to GameOutLoudPodcast@gmail.com. Or you can find us on Twitter at GameOutLoudCast. And thank you guys. We'll be back next Monday with another stream for you. Not sure who's going to be on. Not sure what we're going to talk about, but I'm sure it'll happen. So thank you very much for listening in to our return episode. And Jack, thanks for coming on, buddy.
Hey, man, it was a pleasure. Good to be back.
Always happy to have you. Ryan, thanks for making the time. I know you are a busy individual.
Yeah, no, I'm glad I hopped on. It's good to see the game from another perspective, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, to get other people's impressions.
Definitely, I agree.
I was going to make a pessimist joke, but I think Ryan has had the uptick and is actually...
I beat you to the punch.
Yes, you did. So, folks, thanks again, and we'll see you next week.
Yeah, Rob, didn't you say you made that in like one sitting?